Good morning. What I would like to do is briefly explain the way UNHCR's mandate on refugees, IDPs, we work, and what are the concerns, what are the issues. We'll go through quite fast. But I would like to actually see the possibility of having more interaction on question and answer and then discussion, because I think that will be much more useful. One other thing is, I have seen it is written also, migration. Refugees, internal displacement, and migration. Migration is a bit different than the refugees and IDPs, the way UNHCR handles, because for migration there is another agency who deals with it, and the issues are different. But I think there are some interlinked connections in this. So from this angle, let me see what we can present, what I can present, and what we can discuss. Okay, let me bring the context of refugees and displacement vis-a-vis UNHCR's mandate. These are the persons of concern: refugees, asylum seekers, internally displaced people, refugees and IDPs, those who are returning back to their country or places of origin, and the statelessness person. Very briefly, I would like to tell you the, not exactly the definition, but who are these different groups. Refugees, what happened? Who they are? Well, you see they are not there?
Yes.
Ah, okay. Okay, I'm sure all of you know who are the refugees. Refugees are the people or the person who is outside their own country or habitual residence, who is unable or unwilling to return due to founded fear of being persecuted for reason of race, religion, membership of a particular political group or party, and their political opinion. So some of these will be left behind, I think, as part of the documentation what will be given. So I think I'll just go through this very quickly. Then the asylum seekers, those who come to a country still waiting to get their determination status to be determined in that particular location. Internally displaced people, those who did not cross the international border, remain displaced within the country or the places where they lived. Refugees and IDP returnees, these are the people, once someone was a refugee and then want to return back voluntarily, or the IDPs who got displaced internally, now situation is conducive for them to return. These are the group of people, we call them IDPs and returning, because this is a large number of people, a lot of work need to be done to make sure that they return in safety and dignity, and they return voluntarily. And last but not the least, statelessness persons. There are a large number of people without any documentation, without any state. Nobody is actually covering them. So these are the various groups what we deal as far as UNHCR is concerned. End of 2013, this is the figure. Quite alarming, 51.2 million forcibly displaced individuals. All those five categories what I mentioned, this is what it is. Out of these, 16.7 million refugees, 1.2 million asylum seekers, 33.3 million IDPs, 10 million stateless people. This is an interesting phenomenon to take note. 50% of the refugees were or are below the age of 18 globally. And again, 70% of the entire refugee population are women and children. That shows the extent how vulnerable are the refugees and IDPs and the persons of concern as far as UNHCR deals with. This is another alarming statistics. During 2013, an average of 32,200 individuals per day were forced to flee in search of protection, in comparison to 2012, when it was 23,400, in 2011, it was 14,200. So you can see the increase in displacement in 3 years span of time, which gone, I mean, if you take 2011, it was 14,000. Now in 2013, it was 32,000. And some of these hotspots are there. That's why it happened, like Central African Republic, Syria crisis, in addition to all the other ongoing crises all over. Next slide is the global forced displacement, but I think this is a graph shows those displacement, the increasing trend. The next slide is something I would like to discuss here. Between the group of refugees and IDPs, asylum seeker refugees, I put them in two groups. Asylum seeker refugees in one group, IDPs in the other group, and there are common challenges and issues and concerns that we are going to see now here. What are the issues and what are the challenges as far as asylum seekers and refugees? The challenges are enormous. It's an enormous challenge to deal with these issues. I have just listed some of them here. When the refugees and asylum seekers leave their country or forced to leave the country, the exodus has following challenges. It's a question of difficult traveling from their places, crossing the border, separation of families, loss of legal document, loss of property. And when they manage to cross the border, then the other struggle starts. In most cases, they do not have suitable shelter. Many of them live in refugee camps. If some of you have, I'm sure some of you have seen refugee camps, those are not necessarily the ideal place to remain there year after year, decade after decade in some cases. This has a lot of difficulties to manage those camps, to make sure that people receive sufficient basic services, the security, the discussion we had, or the what the discussion we are having, the SGBV related and gender based violence related concerns, all these are, a lot of these things exist in refugee camp setting. Then the question of lack of access to essential services like health, education, water, food, you name it. The poor security and safety, which leads to vulnerability and exploitation. Inability to communicate, lack of interpreter services. I work in Sri Lanka. There are asylum seekers. Some come from distant places. It is difficult to communicate with them on a regular basis. You'll be surprised, some of this communication we either rely with an office elsewhere over the telephone, is if you do not see the person, you do not see the body language. Hearing someone making just a translation is not sufficient to understand, to determine the status, to take the concerns. So these are the difficulties. The lack of skill, because some of them are not skilled. There's no skill, no training, no education. So as a result, apart from the difficulties of restriction in a given place, they have also difficulties to earn a living. Livelihood is a question. There are three durable solutions we have for refugees. One is voluntary return, the other one is local integration, third one is third country resettlement. So within these three, if you talk about return, voluntary return, or the integration locally, some of this takes time. It's not that there's no possibility of finding a durable solution in a quick, there's no fast track arrangement here, unfortunately. So it takes time. And within this time, people get literally frustrated. There are other related difficulties. So this is also a major concern as far as the refugees and asylum seekers in a given setting. Then the feeling of isolation is there, prejudice, discrimination from the authorities, post-community. It's not that it is, I should make it clear that the host community and the host government provide security, and they are the one who is the first line of, they are the one who provide security and host this family, but still, this is not as easy one would expect. There are some difficulties on that. Many of these asylum seekers and refugees also suffer trauma, because depression, trauma, anxiety, all these exist simply because many of them left either due to civil conflict, war, their families behind, nothing to look forward. So these are day-to-day difficulties they face while they are in a foreign country. There are other challenges also here. If we see lack of access and respect for organizations that deliver assistance and protection to refugees and asylum seekers, some of these are challenges. It starts from the host government, the community, and other entities or other bodies, either help or work for refugees. So this is one difficulty sometimes we see. You will see the next point. Regulations and restrictions imposed by the government and actors, that is limiting the movements, access to work, essential services of both refugees and asylum seekers. In many circumstances, these are serious problems, because you need to carry food to a place where the refugee camp is. And along the way, some places, there are checkpoints and there are restrictions. And these are the difficulties. Given these difficulties, we need to make sure that we provide assistance to the group. We try to organize it with the government. Sometimes it is easy, sometimes it is not. A lot of discussion, a lot of negotiation. It is a difficult area of work for us. Next challenge is a lack of understanding, knowledge, and capacity among the decision makers, security forces, and refugees, asylum seekers, and related matters. I can give you plenty of examples. In many countries, the first thing, anything is blamed on refugees and asylum seekers. Because this is also a way of diverting attention by the government in a very in a manner that, okay, fine, there is unemployment, refugees come here and take all the jobs. I can give you an example in some country where it says there is 1 million refugees in that particular country and exactly 1 million unemployed in that particular country. Iran is an example. Yeah, there are 1 million Afghans in Iran. The government's rhetoric is a million unemployment in Iran is because the refugees are taking job. One day I asked a very senior government official that, well, there are also three days and 5 months or 6 years old babies. Do they also take jobs? Of course not. So why are you blaming? It's easy. It's easy to blame, so you blame. This is one. So this is difficult because the understanding and knowledge either is not there or it is. They do not want to understand it. But this is an area which we have difficulties. Difficulties in providing the necessary knowledge and skills to facilitate a smooth reintegration process if and when they decide to return to their countries of origin or country. This is also because while they are there in uncertainty, we do not know when these refugees will return. So how do you plan? This is difficult to plan. Even if you plan, it is not that easy to provide all these skills and knowledges, and then they will be, tomorrow they will be on their own feet. These are the difficulties. We need to ensure protection for highly vulnerable population, especially those exposed to torture, serious harm, systematic targeting of SGVV. This is also another challenge. As I said, I just listed few. The list will be, it's not an exhaustive list, it is much longer than this. These are the refugees and asylum areas. There's another list of concern and challenges that is on IDPs. IDPs by nature did not leave or cross the border, so they are expected or supposed to receive the protection of their own country. But in reality that is not happening. So, because that is not happening, their human rights often denied. Next challenge is, many of the IDPs get displaced within the country, but they may move to a place which is not necessarily 100% safe. Maybe a bit safer than where they were. Still, it's a difficulty. Then, protection and assistance. They were displaced, so they need to be protected. They need some assistance, like saving. Basic assistance. Sometimes it is not easy to provide again. Because I know countries, if you talk to the authorities, they think that these are the people you are giving a preferential treatment while the whole country is in difficulties. Government sometimes says, look, you are just doing it, maybe you have some reason to do it, or maybe you have vested interest as an international community. These are the blame sometimes leveled on us. During the movement, some of them also lose documentation. Losing documentation, I'm sure all of us, we know, if you lose your passport, what will happen? If you lose a document, many of those people, they may not carry a passport, but they have some places, you have some sort of documents which you need to have access for various services. If you lose it, then the problem starts even, and problem to be multiple. Okay, problem even multiply more when they want to return. The access to property and things and that, and all these things are there. freedom of movement is another problem, sufficient access to food, water, sanitation, and all this is, these are the issues. And because they are vulnerable, so there is possibility of abduction, exploitation, abuse, sexual and gender-based violence. These are also the problem. And these are other challenges as far as IDPs are concerned. Still, these are the areas. IDP is an area still there are not a lot of clear, I would not say policy, a lot of clarity is needed. So naturally, there are some ambiguity, and that's how there are time to time we face difficulties to convince and to provide assistance to these people. Most challenges are also housing, land property, laws and regulation, in particular in Sri Lanka. I can explain to you what we do more talking. Children and displacement, you know, the most among the vulnerables, mostly the children are children and displacement in this, they are exposed to abuse and harassment. Lot of because during the movement they are exposed to greater physical and social, emotional, psychological risks, become malnourished because the food and services are sometimes lacking, sometimes get abducted, used by militias as child soldiers. The other group, as I mentioned earlier, that 50% is below the age of 18, overall 70% is women and children. So the challenges of displacement for women and girls are again the subject of discrimination and abuse, get marginalized, excluded from assistance available services, subject to sexual and gender-based violence, sometimes gets leading to human trafficking, smuggling, so these are the difficulties, lack of access to income generating possibilities, livelihood, lack of health, education, including reproductive health care, these are the difficulties they face. Next slide is the legal mechanism. I will just make one comment here. None of the countries in this region are signatory to 1951 Refugee Convention or 67 Protocol. So this is the main instrument how refugees and asylum seeker work is done. So many of the countries said, well, we are doing it from a humanitarian point. I was told in one country, take it or leave it. We are doing it on the humanitarian, we are doing you a favor. Thailand in particular, because I was UNHCR representative in Thailand. When this discussion started, they said, well, take it or leave it. We are not signatory. You are not. But there are other international law and there are customary law, and it's not that, but even if you have a sign, so it means you have quote and unquote less obligation that way. That's the feeling. So I read this because there are difficulties in this area of work. Long-term displacement and what are the effects of displacement? You see, the first thing is when the society gets disintegrated, community fiber completely gets, it disappears. There is no community, because when they move from one location, when they either they cross the border or move within the country, get internally displaced, this is no longer a homogeneous community where they were. This village, half these three family members move here, other two move there, father move there, children move there. So as a result, this whole community fiber, family fiber is destroyed. This is one. Long stay in a refugee camp or in an IDP situation also create dependency syndrome. This is what we have seen. Because they are depending on handouts. So naturally, even if you try to give them hope, skill, this, that, it is not that easy. So these are difficult challenge of long-term displacement. We'll be able to speak it about it more afterwards, because there are examples where, just very quickly, in Somalia, there was something called UBAS system. Means the elderly person sit under a tree and find conflict resolution and these and that and all those. Now, what is today Somalia? You cannot expect that, because where they move, Dadaab in Kenya is the largest refugee camp on earth, and every day there is fighting going on because people are trying to survive there. So the whole mechanism of traditional way of resolving conflict is gone, it's not there. I would like to very quickly briefly mention on the last word, beyond, because I think we talk about live or ongoing crisis of displacement, refugees, humanitarian catastrophe, difficulties, this and that. But once the war is over, what happens? Attention is no longer there as it used to be yesterday. Sri Lanka in particular, war is over in 2009, but I can say war is over, the battle is not. This is where the problem is now, because internally displaced people moved back to the places of origin, but do they have all the services? Do they have everything one would expect to have a life, normal life? It is not. And as a result, there is possibility down the line, if we do not keep serious focus on it, then the human tragedy will start again, including the human rights abuse, including the violence and gender-based violence, hardship, all this is there. We can talk it more. The rest are what we do in UNHCR. I think we can talk about it. These are some of these things we do. One last point I would like to mention also. What we have, well, I think I can take a little, I'm not surprised. We have started something in Sri Lanka. What I am trying to do now, providing training to the security forces and police. Because I went to the government, I told them that you are sending peacekeeping forces and police forces for peacekeeping. So I would like to do the following. I would like to help you to identify who will be going. So we will provide refugees, human rights, and gender-based, prevention of gender-based violence, this type of areas of discussion training. So you will have qualified, experienced people going to represent your country. So I think they like it. They thought, okay, fine, this is good. And I also said that this, I have the other advantage, because these are the people going to deal with persons of concern for UNHCR in that particular location. So it is win-win situation for both. So I think I stopped here, and we'll be able to discuss anything.